Where would we be without that great sacrifice? Good to be back with you again today after we've got my date all straightened out here. Doctor says it's time to start acting 66 and not 36, and maybe he's talking about my memory too. I don't know. But I do know this. I still serve a God that's got it all right square firmly in his hand. I don't have to really worry about it. Just got to do my part. Sometimes that gets a little tough too, but God knows all about it. Amen. Linda said to tell y'all hello. She loves you and misses you today. We had probably the best Christmas ever that we've had in a long time, maybe ever. We got to go be with our son in Colorado. Our granddaughter, Madison, who is six, says, "Papa, it's Colorado. You got to say it right." So we got to go to Colorado and be with our son and his wife and daughter and had the best time. And thankfully, because as you know, we've been praying about our relationship with our kids for a long time. And our daughter actually put us up in a motel out there so that way I wouldn't have to worry about getting caught up with any bad allergies with a couple of big dogs in the house. I mean, they're good dogs, but they're just big dogs. And my allergies are getting worse as I get older. And she even supplies a couple of EpiPens to take with me just in case. But thank God none of that got like that, but we had a great time. And on the way back home, we were getting on the shuttle to go back to Denver to catch a plane to come back home. And we're still not really sure what happened when Linda went to sit down on the shuttle. She missed the whole seat and landed right in the middle of them. And on this particular shuttle bus, they've got these big old metal seatbelt rails that are about that high above the seat, and she landed right square on one. And long story short, she gave up and finally went to the doctor about 2 weeks later because she said there's nothing they can do, but she was hurting so bad. But finally went, and the doctor said, "Well, there's so much swelling still, I really can't tell, but I can tell that you cracked at least two places, and it's right where the muscle tissue and nerve endings come together." So she's been really hurting. And yesterday was kind of a rough day for that. And we're really praying hard about her going to Florida with me this year, because the last couple of years she's missed it and hadn't been able to go for a lot of other things. But this year we really want to go. Last year she got to take a cruise with some of her girlfriends that she's been hanging out with. They have their little ladies outings going on. Last year they went on a cruise to the Bahamas. And she came back, she said, "I really wish that you and I could do that." So I surprised her a little while back. I said, "I got one scheduled." She said, "You got what scheduled?" I said, "A cruise." So we've got a four-night cruise that goes out, and we're going to be in Florida. It goes out of Miami. So if we're already there, that'll make that a whole lot easier. So we're praying about that. And in anticipation of still not trying to take it easy on her, we got Sterling now, and our cat, which came from here, you guys, through Debbie Russell. And where's she at? She what? They heard I was coming, huh? So, well, tell them well, I missed them today. But Dawn and Debbie actually delivered Sterling to our house the first day. He was 7 weeks old, and I guess we found out he's got part Maine Coon in him. He's just the sweetest little thing you've ever seen. What is today? The 18th? He'll be a year old tomorrow. And y'all brought him to our house just before Good Friday last year. We've become. He's like one of the family for sure, better than family. We love him, but not to say you can't love family, but y'all understand where I'm going with this. But usually when we're on the trips and she gets to go with me, we've been leaving him. Some friends have been taking care of, but our Florida trips are always longer trips. We just can't imagine being away from him, especially Linda being away from him for 7.5 weeks. So I said, well, I think I've prayed about this and thank the Lord showing me. I still got a couple things I got to figure out. So in anticipation of not leaving him at home for 7 weeks and not leaving her at home for 7 weeks, I said, here's what we're going to do. You just kind of take it easy until that time, and I'm trying to take care of everything that I can to help her out as much as I can. I said, but when it comes time, I said, Sterling and I will drive down, and we'll take your car, that because the Kia Soul is the only one she can ride in. It's for her back, and now with the tailbone issues that are going on. I said, we'll just leave a couple of days early, and we'll drive down there, and I'll get you a flight. We'll just fly you down, and I'll pick you up on the airport on Monday. That way you won't have to hurry or worry where everything's going to be. We'll all be okay. We've got a couple of friends that's already lined up to take her to the Richmond airport for us so I can pick her up. So 2.5 hours in an airplane is a whole lot better than 14, 16 hours riding in a car. So that's kind of where we're planning. We could take the RV, but once we got there, we can't. There's no way to take the Kia Soul because it's an automatic. I can't hook it up to the RV and pull it. So we still wouldn't have a way to go between the real driving once we got there, because we'd be all over Central Florida for the next 7.5 weeks. So we're trying to get that, and I've already got the flight set up. And the Lord's blessing. I got a $21 flight. You believe that? Yeah, that's what I said too. So I think the Lord's smiling on that idea. It's just figure out, we get all the other details figured out. But she said to tell you hello, and she misses you. She hated not to get to be with you today. But maybe the Lord, by homecoming, we'll get that all figured out, and she'll be able to make it back then. So that's good. I'm rambling on and on a lot this morning, ain't I? So, just trying to catch y'all up, because you're better than family does too. We love you too. So, and we're just, every trip to Solid Rock is just, it's a good day. I don't care. On our worst trip coming over here, it's always been one of our best days. And you guys make it that way because you bless us so much just by loving on us the way you do and allowing us. And then you got Dave and Donna. What more can I say? You know, you got the best there is. And I know that God just smiles on you guys. He has for a long time. And just thankful to see how God has used you over the years and to see what God's doing with you even today. And to know that it's not just the people that come and sit in the pews here, but people all over the world are being touched by you guys. They see what God is doing in you and with you, and now it's through you to reach them. And you just, I mean, you can't find that everywhere you go. I was at a church, I think, just last weekend, and they've had a lot of sickness that are going through there. And the pastor's a good friend of mine, not like these friends are, but he's still a good friend. I love him to death. And he said, you got to understand, there may not be much of a crowd today. And I said, well, brother, the day I come for the crowd is the day I got to quit what I'm doing. Now, I didn't come for the crowd. I came for the Lord. I get a whole lot of things wrong in my life, but this I do understand. It's not about me. It's about him. And that leaves me room to work on everything else I need to do. Maybe it's a good time to share this with you. Somebody, you know, I think I've even shared with you, I've come here time before, and I made the statement, you know, I don't have to understand God. Well, I found out I was wrong. Not totally, but still, in some of the context that I've been sharing, I'm wrong. I don't have to understand God. And I'm absolutely right whenever I went to the other part of that, and I said, but I do have to trust God, because that's what the Word says over and over again. Trust God. Trust him and know that he's able to do whatever he says he can do. But I was sitting in a church, and a guy brought out a scripture in Jeremiah chapter 9, and it hit me right smack between the eyes. It talks about the things that men glory in or boast about, and how they talk about things that, you know, they really are proud of themselves over, and the things that they know so much about and they have great understanding in. Well, Jeremiah chapter 9, I believe it's around verse 23, 24, somewhere right down in there. The God himself, speaking through Jeremiah, says, boast in this, that you understand and know me. And I thought, oh, well, now I got to rethink this whole thing, don't I? And after digging into that and listening close to what that man had to say that night, I figured out a few things, that I was kind of on the right track, but I still had to change my way of thinking, because I have to understand God. I still don't understand why some people get sick with certain diseases and they die, and others get well and it's like they never had it. I don't understand why young people have to die and why kids sometimes leave this world before their parents do. I don't understand that. But I understand this, that regardless of the situation, the God that I serve, the God that's in this book that I hold in my hand today, is still the God of all gods. And I understand that he has a love for me that is second to none. And I understand that although I'm not all-knowing and that I'm not all-sufficient in myself, I understand I've got to lean on him for everything that I need. I understand that he is God. And I understand that it's not up to me what God wills or what God allows. But I understand this. It's up to me to go with God no matter what those situations bring. I saw a little section on TV yesterday afternoon. I was putting some stuff on the grill, fixing things for our dinner. But I caught parts of it as I came in, something I didn't know before. Anybody ever watched this comedian Sam Kinison? I used to think the guy's hilarious, but he's just nasty. The man used to be a spirit-filled preacher. But he turned his back on God because he couldn't figure out some things and because he thought that he'd been abandoned by some of his church people. And he turned his back on God because he didn't understand this. That regardless of your situation, regardless of your circumstances, regardless of who likes you or who doesn't like you, regardless of what your standing is in life, that irregardless of what you do or where you've been, you still got a God that's going to be with you through the thick and the thin. He's still God even when things are at their worst. He's still God when things are at their best. He's still God no matter what's going on. If nothing's happening, he's still God. And the quicker that we learn that he is God and that we've got to keep our trust in him no matter what, then we'll understand this, that God will always see his children through. You may not get what you want, or you may get what you want but not like you wanted it or like you think it was supposed to come. But if it comes from God, understand this, it will be the best for you in everything in your life. Because this thing I do know and I do understand. I've tried my own ways and fell flat on my face every single time. I have done my own thing thinking that I was the wisest one, that I had the better idea, and not realizing this, that God had his eyes on me and he knew that I was about to make the biggest blunder of my life, but he let me do it anyway so that I would learn that he is God, that whenever I do surrender myself to him and let him know that I realize that he is now God, he will take it to a level that I never could have dreamed of. And it's because of my own disobedience and because of my own selfish attitudes and my own ways of doing things. I understand this now, that there's no telling what I may have held myself back from what God wanted to bless and how God wanted to move, but he couldn't because I was so smart. Now I'm smart enough to realize I blew it. There's some of you in here today that's about my age, and some of you that may be a couple days older than I am, but there's several of you that are a lot younger than I am today. Understand this. The plan that it talks about in Jeremiah 29 is absolutely true. But that plan cannot come about until you surrender your will 100% to God's way of thinking. You won't understand it. You won't figure it out. But this you will understand. He is God. And all he wants to do is show you. But he can't until you understand that you got to get out of the way. And now, at the ripe old young age of 66, I'm trying to figure out, God, how do I get out of my way and get out of your way so that your will and your way can come alive in me. We value things sometimes that we ought not to value, and some things that we ought to value that we put too much value in, and then the things that ought to be the most valuable in our life, sometimes we devalue those to the point to where they become worthless. And we've got to be careful in what we pick and understanding our priorities. Some of you may have read the last month's newsletter that we sent out. It's centered around another lesson that I got to listen to on a Wednesday night. A man got up and he opened his service, that sermon that night, with a story on a program that he loves to watch, the Antiques Roadshow. A lady came in and had a lion statue in her hands that she was carrying. And as soon as the man saw it, he became intrigued with it. And the closer that she got, you could see the anticipation in his eyes of wanting to get closer to it himself. And as he takes the statue, that little lion, you can see tears begin to well up in his eyes noticeably. And he asked the lady, "Do you know what you have here?" And she said, "Well, this is just a family heirloom that we've had in our family for generations that I know of." He said, "Yes, ma'am, but do you know what this is?" "I just know that it was passed down to me, and I've kept it, you know, in the closet and kept it, you know, wrapped up, and sometimes I use it for a doorstop and other things." Come to find out, it was a statue that dated all the way back to the Jing Dynasty. Now, I had to go back and do a little research on my own to find out, because I'm not a history buff. And when it gets outside of my own history, I really struggle trying to figure it out. I can't even remember my own history a lot of times. But evidently, the Jing Dynasty was pretty popular. And he began to describe this lion statue to her. And it's like it was just coming alive in his hands as he was talking about it, the man said. What this thing had been through, the family heritage and what it represented and all the years. And she said, he looked at the woman and he said, "Do you have any idea of the value of it?" And she kind of flippantly looked back at him and said, "Probably a few thousand dollars, I would guess." And by now, the man's got tears running down his face as he's still talking about this thing. He said, "Then it would become as a big surprise to you to find out that this particular statue right now is worth over $500,000. And then the speaker had us open our Bibles to Solomon chapter 2. It's one of the many wives that Solomon had. I still wonder how he could be the wisest man in the world and have 700 wives and 300 concubines. I can't take care of the one I got. We'll talk later. But you're right. But he's seen this Shulamite girl working in the fields, just a poor, no ancestry as far as royalty is concerned. But automatically he fell in love with this little woman. And evidently when she saw him, she fell in love with him as well. I mean, the kind of head over heels kind of in love kind of stuff. And they proclaimed their love for each other. If you read Solomon chapter 2, the Song of Solomon, you'll see what I'm talking about. How they're proclaiming their love for each other and how they just mean so much to each other. And what it's got to be to get together. They just can't be apart. They've got to, I mean, you talk about ooey gooey stuff. I mean, it's there. But, I mean, they're just wanting each other so bad. And it's coming out right there in the Bible. It's, you know, the Bible's telling this story. And as the speaker who was talking about this, he was relating that type of love and the value of the relationship. And he was correlating that to our walk with Christ. And as he's talking about our walk with Christ, which is our most important walk in this life, our most important relationship, I'm really taking to heart what he's reading out of Song of Solomon, and I'm thinking, man, God should be my number one. But Linda should have been number two in everything, all across the board. My priorities haven't always been right. And I would try to justify that in my own mind and things that I would do. But Lord, and then I'm reminded of Matthew 7:21. Not everyone saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Just shows that there's a whole lot of room for improvement for my priorities and the value that I place on my relationships. Yes, God is and should be number one. And my wife should be number two. And then we have other relationships that fall in somewhere beneath that. And as I listened to this man talk about relationships, he concluded by switching back over to the story from the road show. The man still in tears as he talks about this once beautiful lion statue that now has been mistreated, misused over the years. Remember I told you, he said, lady, it might come as some surprise to realize that this is worth over $500,000. He said, you really don't know what you have here. Because you see, this same statue that we're talking about right now, probably 8 to 10 years ago, would have been worth over $1 million. But because of the way that you've handled it or mishandled it, over the years, the value has decreased. What about the value in others? Because of my actions, because of my treatment of them, because of the way that I have handled them over the years, and I'm hoping that you're relating this with yourself as well, have I increased the value? Or have I decreased their value because of the way that I have mishandled things? I think it kind of goes hand in hand looking back on some of these things now, that if your relationship with others is lacking, then your relationship with God is lacking as well. Especially when Jesus talked about, when the Word of God talks about loving our wives, love your wives even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. There's a whole lot of folks today that have faith that God has saved them, and they don't even have enough faith to get to church on Sunday morning. What does that say about a relationship there? Or we love the Lord so much that we can't even make it to a midweek service. And based on what he gave us to do as our commission in this life, we love him so much that we can't tell anybody else about him. Don't fit, does it? It doesn't fit. Well, safe to say there's a lot of things that I say that don't fit with what I really do. And I heard, I think it was Pat, Brother Jim, was doing the Sunday school lesson this morning saying we're going to be sinners until we die. But I don't think we should be sinners that sin automatically. Sin should not be our way of life. Sin should not be one of our habits. If they are, what did he save us from? God, help me be more like your Son, Jesus Christ, every day. And not to take that so lightly anymore, but to realize the most important thing I can do in this life, by what your eyes can see, is to honor God by honoring those that I come in contact with, those who are a part of my life. If I cannot honor God in my relationship with you, how can I honor God? It's easy to overlook sometimes. It's easy to get so wrapped up in things that we're doing. We have things that are going on that, you know, well, it's, you know, God understands. He sure does. He sure does. And that could be a real scary thing when you think about it, because God understands you better than you understand yourself. Boast in this, that you understand God and you know him. Because if you can really boast in that And I know we got to be careful about what we call boasting. And heard one guy say, if you can do it, it ain't boasting. I'm not really sure if that fits in everything, but wouldn't it be great if we could boast about how great our love for God is and people could actually see that in who we are and what we do and how we are? Not just what they see in public. What was somebody defined integrity as? Your integrity is not what people see when you're in front of all of them. Your integrity is what you do is when you're nobody else is around. That's integrity. That's how you measure. And I believe that's what the Lord was talking about. He said, let not your left hand know what the right hand's doing. Those are not the things that we want to put out there on display for people to say, oh, isn't it so great? Because I think it's in Matthew chapter 6 when Jesus teaches how to pray and how to give and how to fast. He said, you got to be careful doing those things in front of men, because if you do those things in front of people for them to see you, you've already got your reward. Whatever you think might be going to get in heaven, if you do it for men to see you, your reward's already done right here. We have to be humble before the Lord. We have to be careful about what we do and to know that God's always watching and to treat him like he's always watching. Amen? I found this old song the other day when I was thinking about this very thing. I don't know if this will be the last song of the day or not. I just feel like I need to sing it right now. I believe it was the Apostle Paul that wrote, and I don't remember exact scripture exactly how he wrote it, but those who say they're saved, those who have given their hearts and life to Jesus Christ, and then they keep on sinning, it's like they're trampling through the blood of Jesus. And I know that Jesus will never be crucified again. That was a one-time event for me and for you and for everybody that was ever to come, or ever who had been, and it would never happen again. Not to the Lord of glory, not to the King of kings. But as human beings, when people hurt us, they hurt our feelings, they step on something, do something that just really digs deep inside of us. How often is it that that person walks by that you don't at least think about that? It has an impression upon you for the rest of your life. You know what they did. Or maybe you've done that to somebody else and you see that person, you can't walk by them without thinking, I know I hurt them and I know what I've done. Forgiveness, yes. God forgives and forgets. We forgive. Sometimes that forgetfulness gets a little tough. Yes, if we get things sorted out and get the right kind of forgiveness, we can soar through these things, and the pain of it can actually take us to a different level in our relationship than we had before. But to actually forget all the ugly things that were done. And I wonder what Jesus must think when he sees us as his now blood brothers and sisters, ones that he died and gave his blood for, whenever he says that he knows that he's forgiven us. And I know that our sins are forgiven and forgotten. But from a human standpoint, what would it be like if Jesus could look and remember whenever he sees me act up one more time? And I wonder how that's got to make him feel. I don't know, but wouldn't it be great if we get to the place where we think, oh Lord, I can never do that again, because I know it's got to be heartbreaking. I know what I did to somebody else, and I know about how much it hurt them. If we could approach that with the same thing and know that God has a better plan, what would it be for all of us? If you need to do that and seek the Lord today, come on, this altar's open. They tell me Jesus died for my transgressions, and that he paid the price.